let's stretch and stand together.
Stretch.
Reach out. We're so glad you're here this morning. Aren't you grateful for the amazing grace of God? Let's sing to Him. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. Let's think about that for a moment. That you would bear my cross. Get us going there, brother.
Sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless with awe and wonder, the King of glory, King above all kings.
This is amazing grace.
This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. King above all kings
and nations,
with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings.
This is amazing grace.
This is unfailing love. That you would bear my cross. You lay down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
Sing,
worthy is the Lamb who slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Sing for all that you've done for me. what you've done for me.
Give him the glory, he's worthy. Jesus, you are worthy of all of our praise and glory and honor, for without you we would be hopelessly and eternally lost. Without you, we would not know the wonder of being in personal relationship with our Creator God. Without you, Jesus, we wouldn't experience your love, your presence, your life, and our lives would have not been changed. So we give you the praise. We thank you for your love and grace. We ask, Lord, that you would pour out anew upon us, anew and afresh, your glory and presence on our time and in this place together. This is your sanctuary. This is the place of dedication. This is the place, Lord, where you are free to dwell by your power and by your presence. We give you the glory. Bless each and every one who's here today. We pray in a brand new way, Lord, for your mercies are new every morning. We give you the praise in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. God bless you. You may be seated. So glad that you're here today. May the Lord bless you abundantly. Well, praise God. We kicked off the Bible quizzing program yesterday, and we had a bunch of kids here, and it was wonderful. We're so glad that all the kids, and you know, I heard from one of the moms who actually, her kids are graduated now, and she shared with me a little bit of her testimony, and I asked her if she'd come and share sometime. She said, well, I live over in Prescott Valley now, so maybe we can record it. So I'm going to give you a sneak peek in case we make that happen of what she told me. She said that she is so grateful that we offered this program because, she said, because of the Bible quizzing program and my kids being involved in it, my husband accepted Jesus as his Savior. When we were in the program and the kids were learning their Bible verses and learning all of that, my husband became involved and because of that. So she said, I'm so glad that you are offering this program for our kids. So I want to encourage you, if you know of any children that would like to be involved in the Bible quizzing program, be sure to let Christy know. And by the way, Christy, thank you. Thank you for your leadership. Thank you for keeping it going. Thank you for all of your leadership and the work that you and your family are doing with the Bible quizzing program. Our growth tracks got started today, and we had many, many of our folks who were in the various classes, and what I saw and heard was fabulous. So I'm excited, and it's not too late for you to be involved in one of the classes if you're interested. Be sure to come back next week at 9 o'clock, and you can have your choice of a class on biblical creation versus the theory of evolution, or can the Bible be trusted, or why Jesus? Why Jesus? So those three classes are available to you. If you would like to sign up for one, but you really want to be in the other one, it's okay, because we're going to offer it again down the road, and you'll be able to get in the other classes. And then starting in September, we'll offer three new choices for you to be sign up and be a part of. What an exciting time. 6 weeks of your time in each of the classes, equipped, encouraged in your faith. You will want to, there's still time to get in, but we'll also be offering some new classes coming up here fairly soon. Our men's breakfast, this is supposed to be this next Saturday. We're going to go ahead and cancel that, and I think you understand why, because we're going to be preparing for the memorial service for August Ketterling. So we're not going to be having our men's breakfast next Saturday, so that preparations can be made for the memorial service for August Ketterling, and that's going to be this next Saturday at 2 o'clock. I hope you'll come to honor the life of this great man. You know, he might be a little guy, but you know what they say about dynamite? It comes in small packages, and that was a dynamite man, wouldn't you agree? And we want to honor his life, but also be a blessing to Jeanette and to the family as well next Saturday afternoon at 2 o'clock. Our Roundup Sunday is coming up. We're excited about Roundup Sunday. We do this once a year, And this year is going to be exceptional because we have a very special guest. Dennis Agajanian is going to be here. Now, we've arranged for Dennis also to be doing the pre-rodeo service, pre-rodeo concerts, if you will, prior to the rodeo on Friday night and Saturday night. And then he's going to be here with us on Sunday morning. Internationally known, he's traveled with Billy Graham Organization literally all over the world for many, many years. And it's going to be a lot of fun. Get your boots out, get your hats out, and come. We're going to have a great roundup Sunday. Now, this is a time for you to invite all of your friends to come and be a part of this great service. So be thinking now and praying now about who you're going to invite. The flyers that are in there are for you to use as personal invitations to let people know about that. I hope that you'll take advantage of it, and let's have a great crowd here on Sunday morning, August 20th, for the Roundup Sunday. Then, of course, we'll have our fun meal together, barbecue that we'll have, and some cowboy games. Somebody in here is going to win the Golden Cow Pie Award. So I know you'll want to be a part of that to see who can throw a cow pie the farthest, okay, and win the Golden Cow Pie Award. So that's going to be a lot of fun. And as always, we want to thank you for your generous giving to the Lord and to the ministries of the church so that we can do the Bible quizzing, so that we can have the classes, but also so that we can support our mission work all around the world. So I want to thank you for your giving. There's a box in the back for you to give your offering, and I just want to thank you for your generosity. And once again, let me say, God blesses those who are faithful. Amen. He blesses abundantly those who are faithful. So I want to encourage you to honor the Lord with your tithes and your offerings. We've got a birthday. Dave Anderson is tomorrow. Dave, happy birthday. We celebrate Dave's birthday. And I don't see Renee here this morning. They usually sit in the back over here. And so Renee, Rich and Renee, they're usually here. Her birthday is on Thursday. So we're excited about that. We want to wish her a happy birthday as well. I want to do something special this morning. I didn't warn anybody about it. But I would like the following four people, if you would come. Ardo, Sarah, Hunter, Amy, and Christy, I'd like for you to come too, if you would, please. Ardo, Sarah, Hunter, Amy, would you come at this time? These four are teaching school. They're school teachers. And I want us to pray for them as they begin a new school year. And I want Christy to come because she is working hard to teach the kids for the Bible quizzing, and she was a retired teacher herself. And so I'd like for us to bless them and pray for them. Can we do that right now? Just kind of stretch your hands out towards them as though you're resting your hand on them, and let's pray for them. Father in heaven, at the beginning of this new school year, just started this past week, we together combined pray your blessing and anointing on these teachers, that you will help them, that you will inspire them, that, Lord, that they will have a connection with the kids that they teach, that it will be a successful school year, that by the end of this year, Lord, that the kids will have learned so much and will be thankful for these teachers. And Lord, that they will love these teachers, and that there would be just that personal connection with these teachers. Lord, in those times when it's frustrating and it just seems like nothing is getting through and the kids are misbehaving or whatever, Lord, would you slip your arms around these teachers and let them know that their work is not in vain, that you are working in the lives of those children as well, and that they would sense a move of your spirit. Lord, they're teaching in the Christian school here in town. And Lord, we also extend this blessing on the school teachers in the public schools as well, Lord, that you would capture their hearts. Lord, that they would not teach anything that is unbiblical, that is antichrist, that they would only teach those things that are truth, Lord, and have that connection with the kids. We pray for the kids too in Payson, in the Payson and Pine public school systems, Lord, that you would do something special in them, in that generation, Lord, that you will speak into their hearts. But now, Lord, we commit these teachers, and we commit Christy to you too, and ask that you would anoint her and bless her in a special way as she teaches the scriptures, especially the book of Matthew, to our quizzers, and help the quizzers to be able to learn and to be excited and to be have a lot of fun as they travel, as the other teams are going to be here at this church for the very first Bible quiz. I pray in advance that you'll anoint this place and make it a sacred place, Lord, that you'll give the kids traveling mercies both here and returning home. And I just pray, Lord, for Christy as she leads this amazing program. And then I pray, Lord, that you'll draw other kids and help us, Lord, when we see some kids to give them a flyer or something and say, hey, you can be a part of one of the best Bible learning programs in the world. And it's through our Bible quizzing. Continue to bless the ministries of this church, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Yeah, give these folks a hand. I have a little gift. Don't run off. I have a little gift that I want to give to each of you. And just to say we love you and we're proud of you and we're thankful for you. Give them a hand and express your love to them. Once again, Lord, we humble ourselves before you and ask for you to be very present in our worship time this morning. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship the Lord.
Let's stand together. To you in thanksgiving for such an amazing grace that continues to pursue us. God, your grace that goes before, we know it is that seeking grace, that prevenient grace that leads us into the place of relationship, God, where we come and ask you into our hearts and we experience salvation. We experience your saving grace. And God, you don't stop there. You lead us into, through sufficiency and sustaining grace, you lead us into a place of sanctifying and cleansing grace, God. But you don't leave us there. You keep leading us into a renewal morning by morning, day by day, as we walk in grace through sufficiency and your sustenance. You continue to cleanse. You continue to purify us. Jesus, you said, the only way people come to me is by the Father who sent me. He pulls. You pull, Father, you pull our hearts into that loving embrace of our Lord and Savior, Jesus. And Jesus, you promised that all those who are drawn to you, you will certainly raise them up. Lord, draw us now. Yeah. Stir our hearts. Yeah. Rend us into that sufficiency of grace. Render us into that sanctifying and cleansing grace, God. Renew that relationship, that dependence that we have upon you. Thank you for the miracle of your grace. Yeah.
You can be seated if you like.
Thank you.
Just to be with you. Thank you for your grace and provision that has made the way for us to be wholly yours, to be found in you, to be known by you, to be loved by you, to be filled by you, to be cleansed by you, to be led by you, that we may love you and love others. Mm-hmm. Speak to us now as only you can, Lord, for we, when every time we encounter you, Lord Jesus, we walk up out of this place and we are never the same. Thank you for grace. Speak now. Your servant listens. Amen.
Well, what a great time it's been in the presence of the Lord already. And we are drawing close to the Lord, and he to us through his word, his own word being spoken to us now by the power of the Holy Spirit. Stand with me, if you would, please, as we look in the scriptures at John chapter 17. We'll be looking at Jesus' prayer, his great high priestly prayer for us as he was preparing to go to the cross. Let's look together in the Word of God. Are we reading verses 1 through 6 and then jumping to verse 11 and then verses 13 through 23? May the Lord bless his word to our hearts. After Jesus had said this, and then you have to say, well, what did he say? He said, in this world, you're going to have trouble. And then he prayed. After Jesus said this, he looked toward heaven and he prayed, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might give eternal life to all of those that you have given him. Now, this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory on the earth by finishing the work you gave me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the world began. In that statement, Jesus is declaring himself to be God, right? God the Creator with the Father. At the time of creation, I have revealed you to those whom you gave me out of the world. Jumping down to verse 11, I will remain in the world no longer, but they are still in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them. Protect them by the power of your name, the name that you gave me, so that they may be one. As we are one. I am coming to you now, but I say these things while I am still in the world, so that they may have the full measure of my joy within them. I have given them your word, and the world has hated them, for they are not of the world any more than I am of the world. My prayer is not that you take them out of the world, but that you would protect them from the evil one. They are not of the world, even as I am not of it. Sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. As you sent me into the world, I have sent them into the world. For them, I sanctify myself, that they too may be truly sanctified. In other words, Jesus practiced what he preached. My prayer is not for them alone. I pray for also for those who will believe in me. That's all of us. who will believe in me through their message, that all of them may be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you have sent me. I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one. I in them and you in me, so that they may be brought to complete unity. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Then the world will know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, speak into our hearts now this powerful message, this prayer that Jesus prayed to you. May we live in answer to Jesus' high priestly prayer. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. May God bless you. Thank you. You may be seated. The world, as you know, had fallen into great darkness and sin. The world had become separated from God because of the original rebellion of man. The world had become filled with brokenness and hatred and discord and death. The first murder took place almost immediately after the fall of man. I mean, already there was a murder, there was hatred, there was division, there was discord, there was death. But God, thank God for his love for us, he immediately set out to save us, to redeem us, and to bring us back to him. Amen? God does not give up on us. I got one amen on that one. God does not give up on us. He does not, he will not give up on us. And he immediately set out to save the world, to redeem the world. Jesus, the Son of God, left his rightful place at the right hand of the Father in the throne room of heaven, and he humbled himself, and he came into this world, and he became one of us. Think about what that means. Almighty God himself, in the person of his Son Jesus, actually became flesh and blood just like you and me. And he immediately began teaching the principles and the values of the kingdom of heaven. Now, we were fallen. We were separated from God. We were in darkness. What did Jesus do? He came from heaven, and he began teaching people about what heaven is really like and what God's original plan was. He came to share with us what the values of the kingdom of heaven, the values of the kingdom of God. He revealed what God is really like and how God wants us to live our lives in such a way that pleases him and brings his spirit into the earth once again, his presence and love into this world that had become so darkened by sin. Jesus, as the scripture said, had completed the work up to that point that God gave him to do. And now Jesus knew it was time for his final act. The final act in God's great salvation plan for all of us. He would offer his own life on that cross to pay the penalty for our sins. Think of it. Almighty God himself paying the death penalty that we deserved in our place. God's final act in his great salvation plan was for he himself to offer his own life for us and take the death penalty that we deserved for all of our sins in our place on that cross. Jesus would be nailed to the cross because of our sins. Think about that for a moment. Let that sink in. Jesus, who knew no sin, the sinless Jesus, the perfect Son of God, taking the death penalty in our place. And that's what Jesus did because of our sins against God. What love of God, amen? What lavish love that God has for us. God's salvation plan all along was that by the shed blood of Jesus, we would be saved. Folks, we are saved from the wrath of God by our faith in Jesus Christ. Aren't you glad for that? We are saved. We are spared from the wrath of God that we deserve when we place our faith in Christ. By faith in Jesus, we are saved from God's wrath. For God so loved the world that he sent his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him will not perish like we deserve, but instead have eternal life. Amen? The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Hallelujah. Before Jesus willingly gave his life for us, before this final act of salvation, he bowed before the Father and began praying for us. He prayed this high priestly prayer for his disciples and, as you read in the Word, for everybody else who would believe. Think about it. Through the disciples, the Spirit-filled disciples sharing the gospel in that generation, and now every generation since then and to our generation today, the gospel has been going forth, and you and I received that message, and we are saved because of the message that Jesus started in the first place. 2,000 plus years later, here we are, disciples of Jesus Christ. And we know that Jesus knelt in prayer and he prayed for everybody who will believe. He prayed for the church. Amen? Did you know, folks, that Jesus is still praying for us right now, right this very moment? The Bible tells us. You want to know what Jesus is doing right now? He's praying for us right now. Amen? The Scripture tells us, Romans 8:34, that Christ Jesus, who died, more than that, was raised to life, he's at the right hand of God interceding for us. He's praying for you right now. He's praying for the church right now. Amen? Just as he prayed back then, he's still praying this prayer for us. Let's take a closer look at what Jesus prayed for us back then and what he is still praying for us right now. Let's take a closer look. Amen. The very first thing that Jesus prayed for is that we would be protected from the evil one. Now, if Jesus prayed this prayer, do you think that his prayers have power? He prayed that we would be protected from the evil one. Before Jesus began his prayer, as I already told you, he told his disciples, in this world, you will have trouble. And we're all going, no, duh. Can I get an amen on that one? In this world, you will have trouble. Jesus predicted that one pretty good, didn't he? Folks, this world, we understand, is separated from God. That's why we have all of the turmoil. That's why we have all of the trouble. That's why we have all of the sin. That's why we have all of the division and all of the trouble that we see. This world is separated from God. And God's original plan for us, it's going to be filled with trouble. The Bible tells us that Satan and a third of the angels in the original rebellion against God, the Bible calls him the prince of this world. So we know who the devil is. We know what he's about to. We know what he's trying to do, how he's directing what he's trying to do. He is the prince of this world. He's also known as the deceiver. Jesus called him a liar and the father of lies. Do you ever wonder why there's so much deception and lying going on in the world today? I mean, even in the halls of Congress, even in the courtrooms, even in the... Why is there so much lying today? Why is there so much deception and deceiving and just out and out lies? Who are they following? The father of lies. They're speaking his language. Amen. He is the prince of this world, the father a liar and the father of lies. Now, he's also known as the source of slander and the destroyer of peace. Jesus said in John 10:10, the thief comes only to steal, kill, and destroy. You can understand that. But what did Jesus say then? But I have come that you may have life and have it to the full. Jesus said, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. Amen? I have overcome the world. Two times in his high priestly prayer, Jesus prayed for our protection. Twice in this prayer. Now, I don't know about you, but when you see something twice, and the professor says something twice, guess what? It's going to be on the exam. Right? So, if he mentioned it two times, Jesus was emphasizing, Father, protect your people. Protect the church from the evil one and all that the evil one tries to do. Jesus prayed, Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name. Now think about that. God's name is in Hebrew is Jehovah or Yahweh. You've heard that before. His very name, the very name of God, his personal name, Jehovah or Yahweh. His very name means that he is the eternally existed one. There is no other but him. He is the all-powerful God. He is the King of all kings. He is the Lord of all lords. He is the Lord over all, all-powerful. That means that even Satan himself must submit to the name of God. And so when Jesus prayed this prayer, Father, protect them by the very power of your name. It says something, doesn't it? Protect them by the power of your name. He moved on and he say, Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name that you have given to me. Now the proper name given to Jesus in Hebrew is Yeshua or Yehoshua. You've heard it both ways perhaps. The very name Yeshua means the Savior, the one who delivers. The Savior. It literally means, if you look at the Hebrew and the construction of the name, it literally means the God who saves. Amen? I love what it says in the book of Philippians, God, oh, and by the way, Jesus prayed, protect them by the power of your name and by the power of the name that you gave me. So what is Jesus saying here? When you start to have the enemy coming around to do the thing that he does, guess what? Jesus saves us out of that. Amen? He has the power to save even in the midst of anything that the enemy, there is power in the name of Jesus. Jesus sets us free from the Satan's grip. I love what the scripture says. God exalted Jesus to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Guess what? Satan has to submit to the name of Jesus. I got one aim out of that one. Satan must submit to the name of Jesus, the Savior. There is power in the name of Jesus. Jesus prayed for us, Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name you have given to me. There is power in the name of Jesus. But then let's look at the rest of what Jesus said there. Holy Father, protect them by the power of your name, the name that you have given to me, so that, and he presents the reason why, so that they may be one. as we are one. How many of you believe that Satan wants nothing more than to destroy the credibility of the church? Satan will do everything he can to destroy the church and what God set out to do. Satan will do everything he can to destroy the witness of the church. Satan does not want the world to see the witness of the presence of God within the body of Christ. Amen? Satan does not want the church to be a witness. And so what does Satan and his demonic forces constantly do? They constantly work to keep people within the church divided and separated and arguing and fighting in order to keep the church from experiencing the fullness of the presence of Almighty God. Jesus prayed this prayer, "Protect them, Father. Protect the church from the wiles of the devil so that the church can be united together, one in spirit, filled with the love of God, filled with the presence of God, a bright shining light in a very dark world, a witness to the world of the reality of the presence of Almighty God." Ask yourself this question this morning. And I wish we had everybody here who's connected to the church right now. Ask yourself this question. Am I praying like Jesus is praying that the church would be protected from the work of the enemy? Am I agreeing with Jesus? Am I agreeing with Jesus' prayer that this church would be protected from all of the attempts of the enemy to destroy it? Am I praying this prayer to God, joining Jesus in this prayer? Jesus at the right hand of the Father, you and I praying as well. Lord, protect this church from all of the attempts of the enemy to try to steal, kill, and destroy. Protect us, Lord. Protect us. Or am I taking part in the devil's work of destroying the church? Am I doing things or saying things that would be working with the devil in order to destroy and divide and prevent the church from experiencing the fullness of God? It's a good question, isn't it? My behavior, my actions, my words, the things that I say, are they agreeing with Jesus or are they actually helping the devil out from being a witness to the world? Which leads to Jesus' second request, make us one so that the world can know. Amen? Make us one. Do such a work within us that we become united together, that we are one together, so that the world can see that God is real. Verse 20 records Jesus praying, "I pray also for those who will believe in me, that all of them would be one, Father, just as you are in me and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe, amen, that you have sent me." Folks, this is Jesus' personal invitation for you and I to become a part of the triune Godhead. Amen? Think about what this is saying. This is Jesus' personal invitation for you and I to join our hearts with God and to personally experience intimate fellowship with the triune Godhead. Wow, think about that. Picture this in your mind. God revealed himself as what? Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Don't ask me to explain it. God is so much bigger. I can't. All I know is what the scripture says, that God reveals himself as God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Three in one, the triune Godhead. Some people use the word the Trinity. I like triune. Tri, triune Godhead, three persons in one essential being. The Bible describes, when you look in the scriptures and look under the scriptures and see the spirit behind it, the Bible describes this tremendous relationship that the triune Godhead have with each other, the tremendous love that they have for one another, the oneness that they share together, the mutual cooperation, each one working with the other, as well as the mutual spirit of servanthood. It's all there. Each one serving the other for the benefit of the whole, all of them together as one in perfect spirit of unity, in a perfect spirit of grace and love that just literally emanates from the throne room of God. Folks, let me tell you something. If we could capture even a glimpse of the presence of God, we would be overwhelmed with the oneness of God and the love of God. You've heard testimonies of people who have come close to the Lord and just felt nothing but pure love. That's the throne room of God. That's the triune Godhead and the very spirit of the triune Godhead. So when Jesus prayed this prayer for us, he prayed, "May all of them be one, just as you are in me and I in you. May they also be," where? "In us." Jesus is praying that we would experience the very presence of the triune Godhead within the body of Christ. The very Spirit of God. This is Jesus' personal invitation for you and me together to come up by faith and be a part of the inner circle. Isn't that great? We're part of the inner circle. We're included in them. May they be in us and participate in the very presence of God Himself. Now, I know this may sound a little bit lofty to you right now, but try to envision what Jesus is saying. Lord, may they also be in us. In the very presence of the triune Godhead, the inner circle. May they also know this and experience this and participate in this. The same spirit of oneness that the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit have with one another, that same spirit in us, in our fellowship, in our church family. Folks, let me tell you something. When you strive with everything within you to have that spirit of reconciliation and oneness together, you are participating in the very presence of God. When you strive to bring about and foster that spirit of reconciliation and that spirit of oneness and love and the presence of God, you are actually participating in the triunity of God. Amen? Think about what Jesus is praying for us here. And then Jesus said, "I have given them that glory." Wow. Think about that statement. "I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one." I in them. The very Spirit of Christ Himself, you in me, so that they may be what? Brought to complete unity. Then the world will know. What does the world say about the church? What does the world know of the church? What do they say? Not a good picture, is it? Recently, I was with a bunch of pastors. They were chaplains for various police departments all around the world, and they were getting together. And one of the things, the common themes that I heard over and over and over again by these pastors who are trying to lead these churches is the spirit within those churches, and it wasn't a good picture. In fact, it was heartbreaking to me. to hear pastor after pastor after pastor sharing what was going on within the churches and the spirit of the world in the church. Folks, how should it be? How about the church being a witness to the world instead? Amen? How about the church being a witness of the Spirit and the presence of the triunity of God within us, and then us showing the world what God is really like instead of the world influencing the church? Think about what Jesus is praying for here. He's praying for us. Jesus prayed to Almighty God that we would experience His presence and glory, manifested by a tremendous spirit of unity and love. And then Jesus says, I have given them that. He was foretelling, if you will, saying, that's what I plan for them to experience. And what did Jesus pour out at Pentecost? Folks, He poured out the power of the Holy Spirit into the lives of those disciples. And the world took notice. Amen? Jesus said, it's done. I poured it out. I poured my Spirit out. At Pentecost, it became a reality. And I wonder, do we have that deep desire to receive this Spirit? Do we have within our hearts that yearning, that desire to receive the Spirit and the presence of God in our church family, emanating from the very throne room of God in us? In other words, do we live our lives in this church family in answer to the prayer that Jesus prayed? Are we committing ourselves to live as an answer to the prayer that Jesus prayed? Or are we saying things and doing things and living in such a way that we're actually a part of the division and the destruction of the church and preventing the church from being a witness to the world? Folks, the Bible calls that sin. Amen? The Bible actually calls that spirit sin. Jesus was nailed to the cross because of sin. Amen? Jesus gave His own life on that cross so that all sin would and guilt would be removed from our lives, erased, eliminated, and our hearts and cleansed instead, filled with the Spirit of love and oneness together. Hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambition, dissensions, factions, envy, all those sins recorded in Galatians chapter 5. These are all called sins of the flesh. Hatred, discord, jealousy, fits of rage, selfish ambitions, dissensions, factions. Folks, that's a part of the sinful behavior. Amen? That's a part of the sinful life. Those are the very reasons that Jesus were nailed to the cross. Because of our sin. Jesus was nailed to that cross so that sin would be what? Removed. Amen? Romans 6:1 says, what? Shall we go on sinning so that grace may abound? By no means. Christ gave His life on that cross so that sin would be erased, forgiven, and removed. Amen? The Scripture says those who belong to Christ Jesus have done what to the sinful nature? Crucified it with its passions and desires. And instead of the sin and the spirit of the flesh, we're filled instead with the fruit of the Spirit, which you know is what? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, self-control. That's the spirit that is supposed to be in the body of Christ. Amen? Not the other, but instead this. And when that Spirit is filling our hearts, and when that Spirit is at the very core of the body of Christ, at the very core of this church family, Jesus said it best, then the world will know. Amen? Then the world will know that you really did send Jesus into the world. Then the world will know that Jesus really is real. Then the world will know that Jesus really does change people's lives. That Jesus changes hearts, and that the very Spirit of Jesus lives here. You know what I love hearing more than anything? I love hearing from people who are new coming in here and later on saying, boy, I sure sensed the love of God in this church family. I felt so warm, so welcomed, so loved. And in the back of my mind, I'm going, yes! They're getting it! That's what Jesus prayed for. Jesus' third request was, sanctify us. Sanctify them. He prayed, Holy Father, sanctify them by the truth. Your word is truth. Now, Jesus is praying this prayer, not just for his disciples back then. The word says he's praying it for everybody who will believe. Amen? Sanctify them. The word sanctify means to be set apart. It literally means to purify, to cleanse, to make holy. It's what God does in us when we fully yield our hearts totally unto Him. God does this work of sanctification. God does this work of cleansing. We are made free from the power of sin and instead filled to the fullness of the Holy Spirit. That's what sanctification is all about. Almighty God, by His power, not only forgives us of all of our sins, but He doesn't expect us to continue living in sin. He expects us instead to go on unto sanctification, to where we are fully committed, fully yielded, where we are set apart totally unto Him for His use, for His purposes. We are no longer of this world. Have you ever seen the little bumper stickers and the stickers, the N-O-T-W? Have you ever seen those? Not of this world. That comes directly from what Jesus said. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. The Spirit of Jesus Himself fills us, fills our hearts to overflowing with the love of God. We see that in verse 26 when Jesus prayed that the love you had for me may be what? In them, in the very culture of the body of Christ, God's love in us, and I myself in them. Amen? The very Spirit of Christ, the very Spirit of the triune Godhead in us. And our hearts are filled with so much joy. That's why Jesus said what He said when He said that the love you have for me may be in them, and they have the full measure of my joy within them. Amen? Jesus prayed that we would take that further step of being sanctified holy, sanctified through and through, set completely apart for His purposes. The Scripture says it is God's will that you should be what? Sanctified, purged of the sin nature, filled with the Spirit of God. And Jesus prayed that this would happen in us. Folks, it is God's purpose all along that we be salt and light for the world. Amen? Jesus said, in this world you will have trouble. But He said, but take heart, I've overcome the world. And here's how I'm going to overcome the world. I'm going to pour my Spirit right into you, and you'll become a light and a salt to the world. The world will see my glory and my presence within the body of Christ. It's God's purpose. That's why Jesus said to the Father, my prayer is not that you would take them out of the world. A lot of times that's what we do. We just wish, man, I just wish I was out of here. And Jesus is saying, no, you don't get it. I don't want to take you out of the world. I want to send you into the world to be a light in the darkness. I want to send you into the world. God sanctifies us. He purifies us of that sin nature. He fills us with His Spirit, and then He sends us into the world to make God known. Jesus said, as you have sent me into the world, I am sending them into the world. Jesus came to be a light. I am the light of the world, Jesus said. He came into this dark, troubled world to be a light in this world. And folks, I submit to you, that's what He wants the church to be. Jesus prayed that God would send us into the world. And I hope you see it now. I hope by now that you see that this is our mission. Jesus makes God known to us, and then we make God known to the world by His Spirit in our lives. The very presence of the triune Godhead in us, the pure love of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit that they share with each other in this church. My question to you today is that what you want? Is that really what you want? Is that the Spirit that you want God to do in us? Is that what you want this church family to be known for? I pray God's blessings on the other Christ-believing, Christ-honoring, Bible-believing churches here in Payson. But folks, what I really want this community to see is that they want to sense the presence of God, that they could come here and know that they've been in the presence of God because of the love that we share for one another. The Spirit of oneness, the powerful Spirit of tremendous love that we have for one another. And when they walk out of here, they will be able to say, I've been in the presence of God because of coming here. Amen? Is that your heart today? Will you commit yourself to living as an answer to Jesus' prayer? The things that you say, the things that you do, the life that you live, together as a church family, that people can see the Spirit of God dwells here within this church family. Jesus prayed for this. He knelt down in prayer for this to happen. And then guess what Jesus did next? He went to the cross so that it can happen. Amen? He literally, willingly humbled himself and was nailed to the cross because of sin, so that sin could be forgiven and what? Removed, sanctified, filled instead with the Spirit of God. Will you commit yourself to yielding your whole heart and life and let God sanctify you, cleanse you through and through? It's His will. Will you commit yourself to letting God do this by His Spirit and then living in answer to the prayer of Jesus? Will you choose to live as an answer to Jesus' prayer? And when the enemy comes around and starts trying to make you say this or do that or whatever, you can simply say, Satan, take it up with my attorney. You don't have anything to say in my life. You take it up with the King of Kings. Amen? You take it up with him. The devil doesn't want to do that. So he just flees. Resist the devil and he will what? Flee. Because he will not and does not want to submit to God and to Christ. Father in heaven, speak into our hearts now as we unite our hearts together around the table, around the throne of, around the banquet table. May your Spirit permeate our hearts, Lord. We thank you for the message that you've given to us. Help us to live by it now. Now that you've spoken it, may your word sink deep into all of our hearts and help us to live as an answer to the prayer of Jesus. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We're going to come now to the table. And we decided to do this intentionally because, folks, this is one thing that all of us can wrap our hearts around. Amen? What Jesus did for us on that cross, His shed blood, His broken body on that cross. I've asked four gentlemen to come to help me serve these elements. If you would come now, please. And I would hope that each and every one of you will know that you've been saved. If not, if you haven't committed your life to Jesus, do it now. Just say, Lord Jesus, I'm sorry for my sins. I believe in you as my Savior. And I know that you saved me now because of faith, because of my faith in the shed blood and broken body of Jesus. And I'll live for you from now on. And the Bible says all who call on the name of the Lord will be what? Saved. It's not an easy gospel because it costs Jesus everything. But for us, God made it very simple for us to commit ourselves and make Jesus the Lord of our lives. And then you can take these elements and know it. You can take it with a clean heart. Praise the Lord. May the Lord bless you as you receive these elements.
You're all I want. You're all I've ever needed. You're all I want. Help me know you.
one thing that unites all of us together is Jesus. Jesus came to set captives free. Jesus came to give life. He came to change our hearts from sin and darkness to light and life and peace and joy and the hope of eternal life. The central person in all of history is Jesus. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one can come to the Father except through me. And by his broken body and shed blood, we are healed. As the scripture says, we, by his stripes, we are healed. Our spirit is changed. Our heart is changed. Our life is changed. Instead of the sin and the bitterness and the darkness and the division and the selfishness, we're filled instead with the Spirit of Jesus. And our hearts are forever changed, and we live differently. And all of us collectively as a church, the body of Christ, we have that sense of oneness together, all gathered around Jesus. On the night that Jesus was arrested and ultimately nailed to a cross, he took a piece of bread before he was arrested. He was with his disciples and he took a piece of bread and he broke it. And then he said to his disciples, eat this in remembrance of me and be thankful. And then Jesus took the cup, and as each one took a sip out of that cup, the cup of redemption, Jesus said, this represents my own blood, which is shed for you for the remission of sins. Jesus said, drink this as often as you do it in remembrance of me and be thankful. And all of us together, receiving this bread and this cup, our hearts are united together around Christ. And we become one together. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And I pray that that spirit of oneness will permeate this church family from this moment until our faith becomes sight. Amen? I speak Jesus. We speak Jesus. Amen? We, as a church family, we speak Jesus. Would you stand with me as we prepare for the conclusion of this service? And let's speak the name of Jesus to everyone.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there's peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus till every dark addiction starts to break.
Amen.
Declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus.
Your name is power. Your name is healing. Your name is life. Break every stronghold.
shine through the shadows, burn like a fire.
Shout Jesus.
Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the street, Jesus in the darkness over.
Into the streets today, when you're driving down the road, when you're at the gas station or at the supermarket or wherever you are, would you speak Jesus spiritually into the life of everyone you see? Can you do that? If the Lord prompts you to actually speak to them directly about Jesus. Do you know my Jesus? Then praise the Lord. But at least in your heart, when you see people, just speak the name of Jesus to them. Amen?
Amen.
Speak the name of Jesus over them. And let's permeate this town, this rim country, with the name of Jesus. And may the Lord give you opportunities to actually share Christ and salvation through faith in Him to someone even this week. And may the Spirit of Christ dwell at the Spirit of the Triune Godhead dwell at the very core of this church family. Amen? And be on the watch. The enemy's heard this message too, and now he's going to try to do stuff. Right? He's going to try, but our hearts are so committed to the Spirit of the Triune Godhead being at the very core of our being now that the enemy won't even have a chance. Because you and I now know to resist and to not be a part of it, but to resist. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you, and may the Lord give you peace. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Have a great day in the Lord. Don't forget tonight, 5 o'clock, our great prayer time and celebration. Have a great day.
My chains are gone.
I've been set free. My God, my Savior, has ransomed me. And like a flood, his mercy rains. Unending love, amazing
in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over.